Good morning, everyone. This is now a technique to reduce the complications in case of the commonest fracture in orthopedics we know, that is our supracondylar fractures of the children. I think this is the commonest fracture after clavicle, or maybe you may not. But this is so important because of the dreadful complications we know till now. And there is a gravity of change by Dr. Devakar's method to eliminate all the complications of supracondylar fracture. And I have tamed it. I say I tamed supracondylar fracture. No problems whatsoever now exist in supracondylar treatment now. Once you can also master this, it will take some time. But you will forget that supracondylar fractures are dangerous after you learn this technique. The current best solution based on Sir Jones Chandler instruction added by my innovation last 40 years of working on several thousand children. Take a recent case, 5-year-old girl, daughter of a pathologist, had supracondylar fracture humerus at Kanpur, a big city 340 kilometers from us on June 8, 2020. Corona epidemic was rampant and lockdown was in force. She was tried close reduction locally with the primary surgeon, but reduction not achieved. She was advised surgery. His family friend and elite hand surgeons from Delhi told not to get surgery in a young girl if scars are to be avoided. So, few also orthos of the Kanpur city advised to visit me for the safe close method in India in spite of the lockdown. They took an appointment and drove a long journey. She even presented first. She had this position, that big plaster, and the initial x-ray, but she was carrying. I took her to the C-arm and seen the reduction was not there. I gave hematoma block immediately and reduction is done. Because of the good stability, inflection, and good vascularity at repulse, pinning was not needed and a plaster was given. As a rule, check reduction compulsorily on day 4 and day 10, even with the stable pinning of the plaster. It was good on day 4, featherweight extension slab, as per Charlie's advice. On day 10, plaster opened, cleaned, and changed again. Plaster was changed locally by a plaster technician to whom I instructed how to get this plaster. And to revisit was not possible here, so I told the plaster technician to continue. At 6 weeks, this video shows active physio and plaster removed at 4 weeks. And then at 8 weeks, near normal activity in ROM, you can see the slight extension was lacking. And on day 90, total recovery and a happy ending story. As ever, almost all of the supracondylars they have now. This is a coax plaster. They apply some wooden slats and apply just leukoplast over, looking like a plaster. It's a tape hoax. Thank God he did not flex elbow, because flexion would have damaged the brachiolarity by the spicule projecting as the anterior beak. Any reduction of the swelling may meet redisplacement of the fracture. But if you have not pinned, it can be very easily reduced. You apply the gravity method again, the reduction is very, very easy. Take only seconds. And final outcome was again perfect. Old method was Thompson's method of the reduction, because he used to pull the elbow in extension and the tense anticubital tissues, they damage the artery whenever you extend it and gave the traction. So it puts nerves and artery into risk going to the swollen tissues. And afterward, you only need a flexion after locking SC fractures. No slab even. Sir Charlie taught 80 years back, you can see in this picture, that he used to give only sling and flexion. No bandage, nothing, no plaster. This is the method. Child's weight is the actual gravity force. It corrects all the rotation displacement, varus, valgus, and everything uncoils back. Gravity method believes that traction and extension damages neurovascular bundle, and that was the cause which gave bad name to the supraglenoid fracture. Initially, the brachial artery damage is very rare. Child's weight exactly what I need. I named this a Devakar's constant that disengages and realign supraglenoid fracture in child and adults both. This recoils the back the fracture displacement by lateral compression of the soft tissues, hang the child just in above 90 degree flexion or slight extension then 90 degree, never flex before reduction is achieved. The moment reduction is achieved, sometimes you feel all sliding into place. Then only flex to the maximum and lock. Locking is by tightening of the triceps. Check pulse here, put the thinnest slab or elbow bridge or only creep. This method tried by thousands of my followers worldwide. These are some examples they have given. As I am saying, people have used, I think more than thousands of doctors are using this method. You can see some of the photographs they have posted. And this is this worked well, and he has pinned. Here, gravity method achieves anatomical reduction always even better than open reduction. You see this fracture has been reduced, but reduction has not been completed and he has pinned it. My next case, you can see the very, very severe disruption. Previously, I used to give this long plaster. This is, I think, about 10 years back. But now I give a very small plaster. So there is a method known as coaxing. This is described by the Charlie himself. He described in the way that you seat again the displaced fracture for anatomical by gently pushing it. So you can see the difference before coaxing and after coaxing. And I always now apply this small plaster. This is acting as a extension block only, because people were educated where Charlie was, but in India they are not. So you have to apply some block, they cannot obviate. You can see the reduction. This much small plaster is sufficient in another case, you see. Whatsoever displacement is there is easily reduced, no problem. And so on, the saga continues. Pinning recommended in unstable fractures only, because this also is not free of the complication. This is one of the messages from some person. This is some ortho from Kadi. He operated a case of 3 supraglenoid fractures, humerus, pre-op SS, the nerves, but maybe pre-op median palsy, which might have, he failed. He said that median palsy is there. Neuropraxia was there. But this neuropraxia you see only when the medial pinning is done usually. Old Gartland classification system was type 1 is non-displaced, type 2 is angulated and 1 cortex broken. Type 3 was completely both the cortex broken and type 4 was complete periosteal disruption. So because there was problem with the Gartland method, so we have devised our own method and own classification known as Devakar Plus classification, because it gives you the better idea. A single gravity method reduces all sorts of fracture and dislocation. So this classification works well with the gravity method. Grade 0 we call the fracture which you hardly see. Only clue is the posterior anterior fat pad sign. So it can be missed very easily. Grade 2 was a stable fracture with single plane displacement. You can barely see the fracture. And on one side, cortex was intact or hinged. And the grade 1, barely see. Grade 2, some one hinging is there. Grade 3, hinge unstable fracture with the medial shift. And here, the intact hinge is on medial side, to which side the shift is there. Grade 4, this is lateral displacement and the lateral hinge is intact. Grade 5 is total separation. This is what grade 4 in the Gartland method, total separation of fragments with a wide gap. Grade 5 was proximal fragment piercing brachialis. This is very common because a sharp proximal fragment, it pierces brachialis. That's what Charlie has warned. If before reduction you flex the elbow, this sharp portion not only pierces brachialis, it can pierce the brachial artery as well. So this was the cause of vascular damage previously. And this brachialis pierce presents as a blue blotch medially or laterally from where it has been piercing. And then grade 7 is this tough fracture, oblique supraclavicular fractures. Previously, this was required some internal fixation by pinning or plating. But now we have devised another method. This is very stable in extension, but adjustment required on day 4 and day 10. And last one is what you call as anterior supraclavicular fracture. Very rare. It is usually green stick, happens only in 5% of cases. This also reduced by same method, gravity method. So no separate method is required, unlike guidelines. It is a brachial artery which makes the fracture so risky. You can see the position of the brachial artery. It is just over the sharp spicule of the proximal fragment. Sir Charlie warns, if without reduction, flexion is done either as sling or slap, proximal sharp bone pierces artery, which is so rare at initial injury. After 90 degree flexion of triceps locks the fragment, hence reduce only just above 90, flex it 90 or more, the fragment is locked. This is 10-day-old SC humerus fracture after CRA with K-wire post-operative CM picture. Opinion, please. You see the reduction is not there because had he applied gravity here, he could have achieved anatomic reduction in 1, 2, or 3 trials. Many doctors in learning phase prefer spinning in all cases as a safety precaution. But without gravity metal, perfect reduction is very difficult. Sometimes full-length plaster where only pronation or supination is needed to maintain reduction. I always apply this vest, this banyan, she applies as extension block. So this gives a very, very comfortable sling-like thing and it keeps the elbow flexed even if the plaster becomes very loose. A slipping of the plaster often follows after swelling subside and plaster sets down day 5 to 8. It should be a habit to check circulation after plaster application. Our most plasters are extension block only as 90% are locked in flexion due to the tricep splinting. Charlie recommends only creep or sling, no plaster. Reduction is always checked before giving plaster some or pinning. It is checked by the, you can see the 3 bony points from the back, or simply check the position of the early crown. It should lie in AP and lateral view in between, in middle. This is what Sir Charlie told 8 years back about coaxing. It's unmagic. You can see with the thumb, he presses the distal fragment further and locks the serrations of the both the fracture site and they are well locked. If you have given anatomical reduction, it doesn't displace easily. Coaxing or seating home is done after first attempt to lock the fracture. Extend slightly at 90 and gently push forward and then flex when you see the reduction has occurred. This is coaxing is the final reduction order. This is the actual method on a subject, step-wise. This is a subject and I am giving you how to apply gravity method in spread. Working on actual subject under hematoma block. Hematoma block is safer than GA. Only slight seconds of pain due to painful muscles because the fracture is painless, but muscles are not. But one advantage is there that hematoma blocks give long-lasting pain relief for 2-3 days as well. And the hematoma block can reduce the pain immediately when the patient comes, even for the X-ray. This is actual supraclavicular fracture. Given a traction for few seconds. And when I feel the reduction has occurred, I just check by supraclavicular ridges. I touch the supraclavicular ridges and see the reduction has been occurred. And then flex the elbow fully and then do coaxing and check in the X-ray. This is a famous saying from Henry Thomas Marsh. He was a renowned English neurosurgeon who remembered for his memoir, "Do not harm stories of life, death, and brain surgery." He tells, "It takes 3 months to learn how to do an operation, 3 years to know when to do it, and 30 years to know when not to do it. Art is a God gift plus honing. Honing means you sharpen your skills. And take home messages, never operate a child unless no other option is available. Keep adopting safer and non-invasive methods as a regular thing." Thank you so much. Thank you for the listening, and apply these safe methods to save the child and the limb. Thank you.